Hey, this is a new blog series we're going to be in over the next few weeks called Terms and Conditions. Each blog is based on actual conversations that I have had with people who are either actively opposed, passively opposed, or neutral on pursuing racial justice in America. In each of those conversations, there seem to be these underlying assumptions that if black people want others to join the fight against racial injustice, then they need to dot, dot, dot. And today's terms and conditions that we're looking at go something like this. If black people want for others to fight against racial injustice, then they'd better watch how they talk about it. It's no secret that the terrain for conversations about race is decorated with semantic landmines, these words that can really easily shut down the conversation or cause it to explode. Words like privilege or racist or fragility or white supremacy. You say trigger words like those, and that whole exchange is likely to detonate. This is in large part because we can't talk about racism without talking about our deeply held foundational beliefs and lived experiences in the world. When we're talking about racism, we're talking about how we believe the world is arranged versus how we believe that it should be arranged. We're also talking about our ability to perceive the world as it is, whether or not we're actually good at doing that. And we're also talking about the way that we perceive ourselves. Do we perceive ourselves as participants in pervasive social injustices or as non-participants in pervasive social injustices? And most of us think we've already answered these questions. We have opinions about how the world should be arranged. And of course we think that we can see the world around us accurately because our experiences that our conclusions about the world are based on are real. And we would at least like to think that if we were participating in pervasive social injustices, that we would at least know about it. And because these ideas are so important, so foundational to us, we keep them under heavily armed guard. What psychologists call the backfire effect has made it into the realm of public knowledge now, and it gives us a scientific explanation for why the conversation about race can be so sensitive and can detonate so easily. Basically, human beings, red, yellow, black, or white, don't change their minds about their deeply held foundational beliefs very easily. In fact, experts say our brains respond to challenges to our worldview in the same way that we would to a literal, physical threat. And because people can generally be so defensive about their ideas, black people are admonished to master the entire landscape, to know where every single hidden bomb is so that we can tread lightly as we talk about our experience of being black in America so as not to trip any of those landmines. We know that if we say one of those trigger words, we can cause our conversation partner to backfire, to retreat, or to explode. And so black people are often expected to get really creative and construct some kind of Trojan horse that can bypass the guards that stand on the walls that surround the precious little worldviews of those who don't know or don't want to know that racial injustice is an ongoing American tradition. Now, there is something to be said about knowing your audience and speaking to your audience in a way that they can receive. I have a mentor that often reminds me, there's a way to say something that makes you feel good about saying it, and there's also a way to say something that helps people to listen. Yeah, sure, that's wisdom. Consider that point conceded. But there are also some problems to these particular terms and conditions. The first problem with these particular terms and conditions is that they don't seem to take seriously the fact that most of us will not change unless we experience some type of discomfort. I'm all for finding creative ways to bypass people's defenses to communicate some truth to them. I'm all for having civil and gregarious conversations. At the same time, we have to be careful that in our efforts to avoid the landmines in these conversations, that we still say what needs to be said. As I think of this, I remember a conversation I had with an older white colleague. He'd said something racially insensitive, and I said that I was going to use that goof as a teaching moment. And me saying the word teaching tripped a landmine. He felt like it was condescending for me to say that I was going to teach him something. And so my response to him was, well, Brad, his name wasn't Brad. Well, Brad, do you know what you're talking about? Well, I don't know, said Brad. So I told him, well then, if you don't know, then you need a teacher. I was that direct with him because I'm not going to avoid telling someone that they're uninformed just because they don't want to think of themselves that way. Fact is, there is no way of becoming a part of the solution without also taking the risk of discovering how you have previously been a part of the problem. And that discovery is likely to be difficult and exhausting and maybe even painful. People are not chomping at the bit to learn that kind of information about themselves. And so it is in their best interest to be told the truth and to be told it straightforwardly. If you were getting blackout drunk every Monday night and showing up to work late every Tuesday morning, eventually you would have to come to grips with the fact that you have a substance abuse problem. You would have to get comfortable with the confession, I am an alcoholic, as a part of your recovery, no matter how badly that confession may chafe at your deeply held belief that you could manage the problem. Some people need to just be told plainly that sometimes they're racially insensitive, or sometimes the way that they talk or the way that they act is offensive to people of color, or that they are unwittingly participating in a culture that victimizes their neighbors, or that they simply don't know as much about a certain subject as they think that they do. Some people need to hear things like that without equivocation, no matter how unsettling it might be. And that conversation can be had directly without disrespecting the person. Nitpicking the language that we're using in the conversations about racial justice could just be another way that people are trying to avoid the inconvenience of the truth. Just another way of pulling out your shotgun and demanding that people get the hell off your ideological property with their dangerous language. And saving people from that kind of discomfort may actually rob them of their only incentive to change. Consider your own body. When was the last time that you shifted positions because you were so comfortable? We don't do that. Neither do we change our minds unless we become uncomfortable. Another problem with these terms, it really is a lot to ask of Black people to constantly engineer creative ways to appeal to opposers of racial justice. Black people already have to deal with the structures of racial oppression and the threat of racialized violence. We need to be investing our energy in things like self-care, not in saving people from their complicity in racial injustice. To say that Black people have to find the perfect language to talk about racial justice is to make us the sole steward of every conversation that we have about race. That is to burden us with the task of managing the emotions of every conversation partner that we have, to the point that when those conversations go south, the Black person is almost always automatically blamed for offending the other party. And that is simply not fair. And finally, and this is probably my biggest problem with these particular terms, is that people who talk like this are basically saying that, well, if Black people want for others to fight against racial injustice, then they better ask nicely. That mindset neither takes the problem of racial injustice seriously, nor conveys any serious intent to be involved to begin with. But most of all, it misses the point that becoming an anti-racist is in everyone's best interest, not just Black people's. We are not pleading with people to save us. We are inviting people to save themselves. Their participation in a culture of racial injustice is ultimately their problem. And as long as they are unwilling to know about their participation in that culture, they can never be free from it. If I approached a friend about their smoking habit, saying that I love them and I care for them and I just don't want to see them die from emphysema. And they got all defensive and upset and started nitpicking my language and saying that, yeah, sure, they understand the sentiment, but I should have went about it differently. At a certain point, I'm going to be like, I mean, it's your health, bro. Sure, when someone kicks the habit, other people benefit from not having to inhale secondhand smoke. But let's be clear, the person who kicks the habit is doing something of great benefit for themselves. I can't force anyone to become an anti-racist any more than I could force them to take their health more seriously. It's up to them if they want to take the scary, exhausting, painful journey of becoming a more empathetic person, a person who's more aware of their neighbors, and a person who's more aware of their own shortcomings. It's up to them to decide whether or not they want to knowingly or unknowingly participate in America's continuing racist traditions. Their freedom is in their own hands. All right, so you heard my take on today's terms and conditions, that if black people want others to get involved in fighting racial injustice, then they better watch their words. What's your take on it? How do you handle conversations like this? Are you the type of person who wants to navigate all the landmines? Are you the type of person who just wants to talk about the issue in a straightforward and direct way? Are you a mixture of both? What do you think? Leave your thoughts, comments, bribes, money, threats, all that in the comment section, and I'll see you next time. Peace.